Welcome to the Tapestry of Life. I am Pascal Scoles, Professor of Behavioral Health and Human Services at Community College of Philadelphia. LGBT is the topic we will be discussing today. LGBT, or GLBT, collectively refers to lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender people. In use since the 1990s, the term LGBT is an adaptation to the initialism of LGB, which itself started replacing the phrase gay community, which many within the LGBT communities felt did not represent accurately all those of whom it referred. In modern usage, the term LGBT is intended to emphasize a diversity of sexuality and gender identity cultures, and is sometimes used to refer to anyone who is non-heterosexual instead of exclusively to people who are homosexual, bisexual, or transgender. LGBT may include additional cues for queer or questioning. Other variants may add a U for unsure, a C for curious, an I for intersex, another T for transsexual or transvestite, another T, TS, or the number 2 for two-spirited persons, an A or an SA for straight allies, or an A for asexual. Some may also add a P for pansexual. The order of the letters has not been standardized. In addition to the variations between the positions of the initial L or G, the mention in less common letters, if used, may appear in almost any order. Besides understanding the evolving social and political aspects of LGBT communities, we as a culture are increasingly concerned about the behavioral health challenges of the underserved population. According to recent Department of Health estimates, there are approximately 51,600 lesbian, gay, bisexual individuals and approximately 300 transgender individuals living in the city of Philadelphia. About 55% of them are men and 45% are women. Overall, many people in the LGBT communities who enter recovery have histories of oppression, marginalism, and scorn directed toward their behavioral health challenges. My special guest today, Rick Ford, community liaison from the Department of Behavioral Health, will be facilitating the discussion. To understand the LGBT community's concern and related behavioral health challenges, we have two guests who will help clarify the issues and reflect on their relationships to the various communities. Kerry Arnold, who is a part-time faculty member in the Behavioral Health Human Services program, will be one of the guests. The second guest will be Lee Carson, who works for Public Health Management Corporation in the city of Philadelphia. Welcome, guests.
Thank you.
Thanks for having me.
You know, the first thing I wanted to ask is, when I was growing up, the word queer was like something we would never use. And I was wondering, in the last few years, it seems to have come into fashion with queer theater and a couple other things. And I was wondering, what is going on with the use of the language? I don't know whether Lee or Kerry wanted to start.
I would love to answer that. When I was getting my MSW, I did a breast health outreach program that was specific to the LGBT community. And when we would pass out information at Pride events, we started to have people come up to our table to say, you're not including Q for queer. And what I started to have dialogue with people in the community about was that to use queer again was a reclaiming of the word, and that it almost similarly to anything that once had a taboo stigma to it, they wanted to really reclaim it, bring it out again, and it also was a word that people used so that they didn't have to be locked into, I'm just lesbian, I'm just gay. I'm just bisexual.
Do you think
that
the word queer is a broader term to encapsulate a larger group of LGBT communities? Is that what you...
I do. I don't know, Lee, if you want to say a little bit more about that.
Sure, yeah, and I agree with Carrie that I do think it's about reclaiming the word and putting a positive spin to the word. I think that there's some debate in LGBTQ communities about the Q, about what queer means, about people embracing that word. And so I think that's within any community or culture that there are certain words that people may not identify with. And I think that queer is one of those words that not everyone necessarily identifies with, but certainly large segments. There's queer theory now. So there are large segments of the LGBTQ community that do embrace queer. But
That's an interesting change in the way in which the word was used. I got the impression in some of the people at the college that I spoke to, there is like, and I use the word queer theater, and that according to them at least, is it a younger movement that's reclaiming the word, or is it the whole communities, whether you're young or old in the LGBT community? It sounded to me like it was a younger population of people.
It feels like it's a younger population of people. The folks that I've met who are in their 20s, even early 30s, really have gravitated to using the word queer. If you mention the word queer to folks that are in their 50s or 60s, they will absolutely reject it.
Yeah.
Similarly, the word dyke.
Oh, yes.
That's, you know, the word dyke has gone through transformations. And so you've got older lesbians, 50s and 60s, love the word dyke. You know, love the word butch.
Oh.
And you have some debate in the younger community about it. Dyke has gone through many transformations. There was a time period, 70s, 80s, dyke was very derogatory, and it was used by people not in the community to say, look at that dyke. You know, something that was really derogatory. And so that there are people that adopt it, they adopt it with pride, and there are people that still reject it.
Mm-hmm. And in fact, there's a dyke march every year in Philadelphia, and it's called the Dyke March, correct? That happens in Philadelphia annually.
Yeah. You know, it makes me think of when, in our younger days, we used the word, they used the word faggot, and things have changed in terms of when I think of queer. I would always think of question, well, what makes it, you know, even when I look at the attire, is there a distorted thing that goes with that, like wearing the black and the symbolism of the earrings and the black nails? Is that, clear that up for me. What's the resemblance with that?
Oh, gosh.
Well, while you're thinking about that, I would assume like every group of people, there's tremendous diversity within your population of people. In other words, there's a wide range of gays, lesbians, bisexuals, and transgender people. And even though you might represent two of the opinions, the same gang of whomever would have a different impression of it. So I have a funny feeling that some of the response that you're looking for might not necessarily be within the purview of your experience. I mean, I don't know this. I mean, I don't know.
Well, it's interesting because I think what, I love what you said, because I would guess, this is just a guess, the folks that I've seen wearing the black nails, it's part of goth movement.
Okay,
and there's a goth segment
within the
LGBT community.
So I think the important thing to note, and what Carrie mentions and what you mentioned, is that so any aspect of the LGBT community can be found. The LGBT community is a microcosm of larger society. So any segment of larger society that you will see, that there's a segment in the LGBT community. And so
they're really,
absolutely. So there's racism, there's isms that exist. Sexism exists within the LGBT community. Racism exists. Goth, folks who are into goth, you know, all kinds of things. People who are really into sports. I mean, you know, there's sports teams. There's, it's just a microcosm of larger society. And I think that oftentimes people don't realize that. People who don't know much about LGBT communities think that it's all about sexual orientation. It's all about sex, quite honestly. I think that that's what some people think, and don't think that we actually have lives and interests and things of that nature that anyone else has, regardless of their sexual orientation.
Yeah. to go along with that, I think about a story that a student shared in recovery, and the student is a gay man, and the student was having trouble finding a therapist, and he kept getting pushed towards going to a gay therapist. And he said, I don't have a problem being gay. I have a problem with drinking. And so, you know, I laugh only because the line of thinking was, well, he needs somebody that's gay. And that, you know, in the context of being gay, he also had issues with alcoholism, and it didn't necessarily require him to stay within the gay community to address his issue of alcoholism.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Do you give a lot of thought to the word, like the letters LGBT? I mean, you know, if you look at the literature and part of the introduction that I gave, people were concerned at the G before the L, and what does that mean? Is it a unified group of people? It surely, from standing outside of it, it looks like LGBT is this uniformed group of communities that are very close-knit and tied together. And I assume, like any committee or group of people, there's a certain amount of things that do draw all of us together in different ways. But I was wondering, you know, is there an issue that goes on within that community around the topics?
As far as the lettering, is if you're asking about sort of, is it GLBT, LGBT, like I've seen it predominantly those two orders, GLBT or LGBT.
Okay.
I don't think that there's, at least in my experience, has not been a lot of debate about whether the L goes first or the G goes first. I certainly feel like our communities have much bigger issues to worry about than the lettering of, is it gay first or lesbian first?
What kind of other issues do you think are going on that need to be addressed in the community?
Well, it certainly depends on which letter you're talking about, which community. And so, you know, we're talking about lesbians, gay, bisexual, transgender. And so I think it's clear, one of the things that I also want to make sure is clear is that transgender, the T, and there's some debate in communities about, because transgender is not about sexual orientation. It's about gender identity, gender expression, and along those lines. And so oftentimes people conflate that with the sexual behavior part, or not, I shouldn't say sexual behavior part, but with the sort of sexual orientation part of the L, the G, and the B. So transgender persons can be, or wherever they identify along that spectrum, can be lesbian, gay, or bisexual as well. And so people oftentimes confuse those. But I mean, there's a litany of things that we're dealing with in our communities. I mean, HIV is a huge issue for gay men, as we know.
Now, you do some outreach men. In that area, don't you?
One Correct, minute. Yes. As a researcher with Public Health Management Corporation, I've worked on several studies, one of them being the largest study ever done in Philadelphia on the lives of black men who have sex with men.
Okay.
And so, you know, we asked men a variety of questions to understand not only sort of about their sexual behavior, but also their experiences with violence, with discrimination, with religious communities, to get a better understanding about what men's experiences are. So, you know, so we have a lot of information about that came from that. But there's also lots of literature and research out there about the different experiences, you know, for men. So there's a variety of things. And I don't want to only talk about HIV, because there's a lot of other things. I know that you and Carrie both are part of the behavioral health department here. And I also work as a therapist, and as well as Carrie and other folks. So know that there's a litany of issues that our communities are dealing with, but also a lot of really great things that our communities are experiencing as well. And, you know, I'll give Carrie, you know, opportunity to talk about some of it from her perspective.
Within the lesbian community, I think one of the issues that really stands out, and it's been ongoing, is the racism that is within the lesbian community. There are literally separate factions. Caucasian women often have many events that are just for Caucasian lesbians, where women of color who are lesbian are clearly the minority at those events. There are events that I've attended where you know that there is a group of women of color. They have their space. They have what they're doing. They don't feel welcomed by the Caucasian women, and vice versa. And I think this is something that is clearly an ongoing issue. It's been very disturbing within the community about, you know, we often talk about, we're already an oppressed group being identified as mm-hmm. as lesbian, and then we are doing our own oppressing within that group.
Yeah. I found that to be quite interesting when I look around, mainly in a lot of the recovery arenas that I frequently visit, I see the separation in the, if you want to call it, discriminatory behaviors, where they stay over there and they stay over there. And I'm thinking, well, aren't they all together? It's really interesting.
Yeah. Lee, you had mentioned that you're doing research at the Public Health Management Corporation. I was wondering if you could share with us some of the things that you're doing and some of the results, possibly, and implications that it might have for us.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so there's a number of projects that I've worked on there over time. So the study that I referred to earlier was called, locally, the Black Men's Health Survey, where 540 men were interviewed. And this was, I think, around 2005 or so was when we did this study. And so we found that, first of all, that there isn't one way that men identify themselves in this particular study. So that there were men who, all of these men also had sexual behavior with men, but some of them identified themselves as heterosexual, some identified themselves as bisexual, some of them identified themselves as gay, some of them didn't identify themselves. They didn't really identify with any of those options. And so, you know, one of the things is that we need to realize that sexual orientation and how people identify can identify in a variety of ways, and that it's not as simple as just asking a person if they're gay, bisexual, lesbian, mm-hmm. that there's just a lot more complexity to that.
When you say complexity, I assume you mean that some people will identify, I guess, as being gay if they even have thoughts about it, I guess, I don't know, or if they had one experience as opposed to multiple experiences.
Yeah, so it's hard to sort of, like, so for me personally, I don't feel like having sex with a man makes you gay.
Oh, okay.
So if you've had a sexual experience, even if you've had multiple sexual experiences, mm-hmm. that doesn't necessarily make you gay. I mean, you could be bisexual. You just may not necessarily identify yourself with any of those. It's just, you know, that, you know, so I think that we have to get away from sort of labeling people based on their behavior because, you know, certainly when we're talking about HIV prevention or if we're talking about prevention of other sexual transmitted infections, things of that nature, we do want to look at sort of who are you having sex with so that mm-hmm. we can give you the most appropriate information mm-hmm. as to how to protect yourself and protect your partners. But when it comes to how a person identifies themselves, I think that we need to leave room for that. And so I, as a therapist, for example, don't make the assumption that the person sitting in front of me identifies themselves as gay. And in fact, I will ask, is there a way that you identify mm-hmm. yourself or your sexual orientation? I think that that's very important when we begin to talk about the behavioral health aspects of things and those, you know, who may be out there who are going into human services or doing that kind of work. Mm. Yeah. It's sort of coming from this, you know, I don't want to say completely like tabula rasa, right, blank slate, but nonetheless that, you know, it's not that you come in naive, but you really want to hear from mm-hmm. that person because every person, I experience being a Black gay man differently than my other Black gay friends. None of us experiences it in the exact same way. Just I, as a Black man, do not experience my Blackness in the same way that you have. There may be some overlap.
And the gayness is the same way.
Correct, absolutely. Okay. Just like I'm sure that, you know, Carrie, you'd probably say that you don't share the exact same experience with all white lesbians.
I mean, right, absolutely.
You know, so I know I got
so
a little bit off of the
there is a certain subjectivity to your identification with the concept.
Mm-hmm.
And it's really through your experience that you identify whether you are or not or with or without whatever.
Right, absolutely. Oh, okay. And so it's very important,
important
to sort of understand what that individual's mm. perspective is and not to assume that all gay men are alike because people often will sort of lump that, well, gay men don't like sports and gay men mm-hmm. are, but there's lots of gay men. And in fact, I have a friend who organizes gay nights at the Phillies, at the 76ers, at I think there was an Eagles game also because, and they're well attended mm-hmm. because there are lots of LGBT folks who like sports. And so, you know, we really have to sort of get to this point of really getting to understand communities and taking the time to really get to know the individual, right? And to not sort of lump all people together. And I know that I'm kind of askew from your question about the research.
No, you're not askew. But But there must be some common elements called the LGBT communities in order for us to provide specialized services. Mm-hmm. I mean, at least the literature says that. I don't know. But, you know, there are the things that are occurring that are unique to women, unique to men, mm-hmm. unique to the gay community, unique to the... So there are some things, but we can't use that as a way of, I guess, identifying everyone in one cluster. Mm-hmm. I guess that's, I think that's...
Mm-hmm. And it's interesting that you brought that up, Pat, because one thing I think about that is unique to our community, and I just had this conversation recently, is every time I'm in a new situation, I'm coming out.
Okay.
And that for some people, if they have not worked through their coming out process, you have people in our community that never discuss and disclose their lesbian identity in their place of work because it would not be acceptable. In mm-hmm. fact, they have fear of losing their jobs.
Mm-hmm.
Some of this is generational.
Yeah.
Some of this is, what is your comfort level with identifying who you are? And do you use a label when you come out? You know, how comfortable are you? I might just say, you know, something along the lines of, you know, I am part of this community. I might openly say I'm a lesbian. I might say I partner with women.
Mm-hmm.
And it depends on the circle, it depends on the context. And so one of the aspects that is not faced in the heterosexual community is coming out as your identity or who you partner with, and that it is a lifelong process.
We have a similar problem in recovery. You know,
yes.
There are places in recovery where, you know, you don't even want to tell people you're in recovery because it has a negative connotation to that group, and it would have a negative impact on the way in which they deal with you. And we've often said in the drug and alcohol classes, for example, you have to pick and choose who you disclose to.
Yes.
It doesn't mean that you're against recovery or against being gay or lesbian, etc. But at this point in your life, sometimes it could have a very negative impact on the way in which people deal with you.
Yeah.
I think it's horrible that that occurs, but I think it's a reality of what's out there. Does that make sense?
Yeah, no, absolutely. And I do think that there's something to be said for. I mean, I pretty much in any space identify myself as a black gay man. And so there's a lot of discussion in communities and this idea of intersectionality, which we talked about a little bit earlier, not here on camera, but as we were prior to the segment. Talked about this idea of that all of us, any of us, are comprised of, have multiple identities, a father, a son, a daughter, mm-hmm. and we sort of interact differently based on what role that we have. And some of us have more stress related to some of those identities in which we have. And so Audre Lorde has this wonderful quote, and I don't remember it to completely to the letter, so I'm not going to try to say it because I'll probably mess it up. But it is about this idea of this, that it becomes very difficult for people when you have to, because sometimes people say you have to be black first and then gay second, or you have to be a man first. And so for me, it becomes, and essentially her quote, the main part of it is that it's a very destructive and fragmenting way to live when you have to sort of pick apart your identities and say, well, I'm not going to be my whole self in this space. I'm just going to be a black man here. You know, I'm not going to be a person in recovery here. And certainly there's real reasons, and we have to sort of, because there are times if I fear for my safety that I'm not going to, you know, that I may have to not disclose certain parts of myself, you know. But for the most part, I live my life as a black gay man. I've worked for black gay organizations before. A lot of the projects I work on, you know, I teach. And so when I teach with my students, I don't come in and say, all right, my name is Lee Carson and I'm a black gay man. However, when I begin to talk about my career and the work that I do, it becomes pretty obvious that most of the stuff I do relates to the LGBT community. So I do think that there's something to be said when you come in and people see that there is no shame, that have absolutely not one ounce of shame about my identity as a gay man, as being that being part of my identity.
You know, it's funny you mention that. I was watching and there's a video that's currently on one of the cable stations, and I can't remember the young lady's name, but it's a wonderful video about
Marsha Ambrosius.
Marsha Ambrosius.
Oh, and it's a wonderful
movie. I love that video.
Very powerful.
And I encourage people to watch that because the message is so powerful. And watching that, I just sat there in my bed and just teared up because you really got.
What was the message?
So the video. It's called Far Away.
It got me curious.
It's called Far Away. YouTube, and it's on YouTube. It's called Far Away by Marsha Ambrosius.
Yeah.
An absolutely powerful.
Yes, it is.
Video. By the way, she used to live here in Philadelphia. Mm-hmm. She is part of a group prior to that used to be here in Philadelphia, Flowetry.
Flowetry. Mm-hmm.
And so the video features, and one of the beautiful things about the video that we don't see enough is Black gay men in happy relationships showing affection for one another, okay? Mm-hmm. So in this video, the essential premise of the video is that she has a really good friend who is gay, two good friends who are a gay couple. And so they come to her, and you don't know this at first until through the song, and then you see the guys come and you see the affectionate kiss that they give to one another. And so throughout the video, you see different aspects that sort of play out and you know, I think a lot of people's lives, unfortunately. Like, so they're at a park and these two little kids come up and, you know, they're trying to say hi to the guys, and the mother sees that they're gay men.
Yeah.
And so she pulls the kids away because she doesn't want them around that. So then what happens as the video progresses is that they end up getting gay bashed. And so you see a group of guys who come up to them and start beating them up. And as a result of like all of this distress, what I gathered from the video of all this distress related to these sort of negative experiences that they had experienced is that one of the friends commits suicide. Yeah. And so you see just, you know, towards the end of the video, you just see pills is apparently the way that he did it, and a cell phone, and you know, some other things just sort of scattered about the room. And he didn't talk about that. He didn't let people know how hurt he was and what was going on with him. And so her video is just amazing. It was a little bit chills now thinking about how powerful that video is. And shows that. And then at the end she talks about bullying and suicide and how, you know, the people really should get help if they're experiencing these things. And there's a phone number that people can call at the very end of the video if they're experiencing these things, a national hotline. Yeah. But, you know, I when I saw it, I was captivated.
Yes,
but also just Black men loving a Black man loving a Black man, which you don't see. Because mostly when you see on TV, at least on mainstream TV, it's white couples.
Yeah.
For example, one of my favorite shows just saw last night is Modern Family. Love that show. It's very funny.
Yeah, it is. It is a very funny show.
But there's very few on mainstream TV. Mm-hmm. Now, there was Noah's Ark, which was all about Black men loving Black men and that whole experience. But that never made it to mainstream TV.
I just wanted to bring that up because as we were talking and how society depicts the whole relationships, and it's the first time openly I saw something like that on television. And in the very beginning of the video, it's him kissing her.
So I'm
thinking the typical normal video again. However, when the other guy walks in the room, I sit back and say, oh, what's this? And again, very powerful. Very emotional, very powerful. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And you know, the in what you're talking about, you know, I'm always out of some tragedy comes some really powerful messages in the media. And in my classes this past semester, we started watching some of the videos as part of the It Gets Better campaign. And along those lines, after the gay bullying and some of the suicides that we heard about, a huge media campaign has come out on YouTube. And it is openly gay folks, all different backgrounds, some celebrities, some not, who were asked to put a video out there to talk about the fact that, yes, it's hard in the beginning when you're coming out because of all the factors we're talking about today, but that it gets better. Mm-hmm. The videos are powerful. Some of them are funny. Some of them are really poignant. You do see people openly having loving exchanges with their partners in some of the videos. And some of my students said after we watched that in class, they had such a different take
on
the gay community, period. that some of my students have talked about their biases and their stereotypes, and that we make it safe to talk about biases and stereotypes, and that the more exposure they get to some of these kinds of things, they have changed their tune a bit.
Mm-hmm. Well, I noticed, you know, I guess I supervise, I don't know, maybe 20 or 25 faculty members in the behavioral health program, part-time and full-time. And I know that there are some of the faculty who are not very forthcoming about whether they are gay or lesbian and do not deal with it in most of the classes. But I know you've taken a different strategy and you feel very, very comfortable about your space that you live in. And it does have benefits in the sense that it allows people to deal with issues that either in themselves, this talk about their gayness or their experiences in life. And so whatever you're doing, it seems to be reaping benefits. And I often wonder, what is it? Do you share, you know, how you came out? I mean, what happens? I mean, because it obviously has an impact on student learning.
Mm-hmm. It has come about a variety of ways. As Lee mentioned before, I don't enter my first day of class saying, "Hi, I'm Carrie and I'm a lesbian." But what happens is I try to work with the flow of the class and the context in which it's just right timing.
Mm-hmm.
You know that in this moment, if I disclose, even as you guys know when we talk about recovery, in a certain moment, disclosure is powerful.
Yeah.
It has come up in my helping skills class. It has come up in my family violence class, where inevitably we're talking about cultural biases, cultural stereotypes. What is our picture? And this sometimes is the entryway. Mm-hmm. What is your picture of someone who is gay, someone who is lesbian? And sometimes I might say, is there anybody in this room?
Mm-hmm.
That you feel you feel that, oh, that's the stereotypical person. Interestingly enough, I don't often get students that point to me. Sometimes I'll say, would you guess that your teacher is? What would that be like for you if your teacher is? And that might be my point of entry, my point of disclosure.
Yeah.
And in doing that, and I know in my heart that is the right timing, it's the right moment.
Mm-hmm.
Inevitably, and I've had this each and every class, students who come up, talk to me afterwards, thank you so much for saying your identity, disclosing your sexual orientation, I am too, how did you do it, I'm scared, I don't know whether I can do it. And just very recently, in making that decision to do that, I've had students who openly talked about their sexual orientation as part of our class discussion. It became very rich. Other students really were warm, accepting. They had a positive experience in that classroom because for me, I did it without shame. I did it without any fear. And I want to be a role model. I want to be relaxed. I want to be able to say, yeah, this is just part of who I am, and it is part of my role here as a teacher in this college. And the fact that at this college, I don't have to fear of coming out. I am not going to lose my job as a faculty.
Right.
That's a really powerful thing.
You kind of mentioned timing is essential. And I guess looking at the culture, your class, knowing exactly when to say, hey, this is who I am, or And I like that because it gave them the opportunity to free themselves. So that's interesting.
Mm-hmm.
It's funny how society, we depict people that are gay and lesbian by their appearance and their attire, even in their posture, the way they walk. I can be sitting someplace and a guy can walk in, and in my mind I can say, oh, he's gay. Mm-hmm. It's crazy.
Yeah, and you know, I think that, so the reality is that I think that any of us are always curious about a person, about people, period, right? So I do the same thing. Like, I'll be like, oh, you know, I think that he's probably gay or maybe. But the thing that I always question us to think about, though, is So what's so important about that? You're going to treat that person differently because of that? And sometimes the reality is, like, I walk into a room, and, you know, I would sort of joke about this, and it doesn't make me really feel uncomfortable. But, for example, we went to a theater production, my partner and I, the other day, and my partner is white. And I said, well, I'm, like, the only person of color in here, you know. Mm. So sometimes I will be looking for just some level of identification with other people in that space. And so I may, if I'm in a general space, you know, if I see someone else that I think might be gay or whatever else, it, you know, does provide some level of comfort or whatever else, or, you know, I may want to try to engage them or something. But the reality is that any of us will pick up on certain cues as about people or whatever else. And so the thing that I really encourage people to think about is, are you going to treat someone differently because of that? Because the reality is that some people who you think might be, are not.
Yeah.
You know, and so that's because our stereotypes, and we have to leave room for the fact that, you know, stereotypes, you know, may have a grain of salt of truth to them or whatever else, and we sort of over represent that sometimes. Mm-hmm. And so so for me, it's like I have no problem sort of coming into a space, as I said, as a black gay man, and just because I said one before the other doesn't mean that I see any one of those identities greater than the other one. But at the same time, I think that I don't want anyone to treat me differently because of that, because there's a lot of other things that I do that have nothing to do with being gay or have anything to do with being black. Mm-hmm. And so I think that we need to leave room, those of us who sort of hold prejudicial views need to leave room for the fact that my life isn't just about being black or just about being gay, though a lot of that's infused in what I do. It's not exclusive. And that we need to acknowledge that. And one of the other things that I feel like I want to say is, you know, sort of we talk about homophobia in black communities, and is black homophobia like worse than in white communities? And so I think that one of the things that I really sort of think about oftentimes is that the black civil rights movement, one of the chief architects was Bayard Rustin, somebody who was behind the scenes, who was a black gay man, right?
Yeah.
And so I think oftentimes we have James Baldwin, who gave wonderful literary contributions, right? And so that our society would be a very different place had it not been for these men. But these men didn't live, though they were black gay men, they were much more than black gay men, if that makes sense. And so that we need to leave that room. And where people sort of feel like homophobia is greater in black communities, it's because we still live in a racist society, right? And so if I'm black and I'm gay, and if I'm open about my gayness and my black community rejects me, I go to the white gay community and I'm not really totally accepted there, it becomes a very limited pool of people that I feel sort of validate who I am, that I can really be myself around, which is, you know, maybe black LGBT folks. And there's not a whole lot of us compared to, you know, the larger society. And so I think that sometimes, you know, that people may feel that homophobia is greater among black populations. But I'll tell you, and this is just my experience, but also the experience of others, is that, you know, I've been lucky in why I can sit here and be so completely comfortable with who I am as a black gay man, is because I've really had very few people who have invalidated that, who had a problem with that. And so I see it as my work as a therapist, as a social worker, when I teach, to try to challenge people to think differently about challenging homophobia and other isms. Even if you're not gay or lesbian, believe me, no civil rights movement, no movement was won without allies. And so it really takes other people to challenge those isms out there, not just gay LGBT people. Mm-hmm. And so it was for that I'm able to be so comfortable with who I am and want to help other people to create that type of environment. And so that's what I see oftentimes as my life's work.
You know, both of you seem quite comfortable in your skin, as they say sometimes. And historically, I mean, how did you get there? I mean, I'm curious as to, I mean, how did you find the space where you say, I'm proud of who I am and I'm proud of what I'm doing and I don't have problems with anything around those topics? I mean, did it happen in your adolescence? Did was it an experience you had? I mean, how did you get to the comfort level that you're in right now?
Well, mine was a long journey. I was well aware, the age of six.
Oh, okay, six.
Wow. That I liked girls the way that boys like girls. Mm-hmm. And having that enter my awareness, I push that away very quickly. I grew up in a farming town in the 60s, 70s, in a home in which this would not be embraced at all, and in a community where this would not be embraced at all. I struggled all through my adolescence, all through my teenage years. I had crushes on women. I held that in. I did what I was supposed to do.
So you were dating guys.
I dated guys. Yeah. I had a high school boyfriend.
Get out of here.
Yeah. And it was uncomfortable.
Okay.
And I did what I thought I was supposed to do.
Yeah.
I struggled for 10 years with alcoholism because of this. That I could not live in my own skin at that time, and I drank to push it away. You know, I had many other things that fueled the alcoholism, but that was a huge piece of my alcoholism, was that who I am is ugly, who I am is not accepted, who I am is a freak. And I had such internalized homophobia that when I was out in situations, and I played sports, where coaches and other people who were clearly lesbian, I made fun of them. I did derogatory, mean things so that the emphasis would be taken off me. So my entry into finally coming out went hand in hand with getting sober.
Yeah, I was going to ask you that.
Went
did
hand
your
in
recovery?
Hand. Absolutely.
Yeah, your recovery played a significant role in you being able to identify and gain some faith and strength that now it's time.
Most definitely. Yeah. So my recovery allowed me to really start the coming out process, and that was a slow process.
How old was it when you started to have this awareness that you had to move in the direction that would give you this level of comfort? Were you?
Late 20s.
Okay.
Were there other people in your recovery environment that were also sharing that hope?
No.
That's interesting.
I rejected my recovery community when I first came into it, and then stayed away from the recovery community, quickly gravitated to the LGBT community.
Okay.
The interesting thing, the way that I relate my process and see folks that I know out in the community is sometimes we hide. We either hide in the LGBT community, or we hide in the heterosexual community.
Or we hide in the recovery
community. Or we hide in the recovery community. And the great thing for me today, and I would say that I truly, truly did not start becoming a whole integrated individual until the last few years. I'm in my late 40s. I would say in the last 4 to 5 years,
and so it took you a good 15 years to go and make the transition.
Absolutely. I made slow transitions, hiding out in one community, rejecting another community, hiding in one community, rejecting another community. Today, I live very open, whole, in my recovery community, in my LGBT community, in an integrated community where I have many friends who are heterosexual. It's been a long road. And I think that for me, it had a lot to do with my roots in really homophobic communities and my own battles with homophobia that took me to this place.
Great.
And you know, I think that what you're saying is great, which is what the Audre Lorde quote that I mentioned earlier that she talks about, and the place that you've gotten to, like this greater sort of self-actualization kind of thing, is that the fullest concentration, like I can be the best person I can be when I integrate all of my identities and don't have to feel the segmentation. And so I think that that's very powerful and you know, happy that you've gotten to that place. And I've known you in that place, so I would have never known, you know, about the other stuff, that, you know, there was such a struggle because you are so amazingly grounded and integrated now that, you know, I've seen you in the, you know, in the other place. So
yeah.
this is great.
Thank you.
Are you from Philadelphia?
I am not, actually. I've been here about 6 years.
Yeah.
But I'm from upstate New York. Rochester, New York is where I'm from.
Right, right.
But I've definitely like blazed my trails, you know, once I got here to Philadelphia, kind of hit the ground running and have been involved in a lot of things. But, you know, so my coming out process was fairly simple. I mean, as I thought about it over the years, that there were, I probably noticed as early maybe as like 11 or 12 that I had attractions to men, and, you know, mm-hmm. but I never did anything, or, you know, I had girlfriends and things like that. Maybe my first girlfriend around 16, and, you know, so, but after I finally really sort of came into my identity and thought about it more, when it became more of an issue for me, was around when I was graduating from my community college up there, from high school, I should say, around the age of 18. And so from there, it was a short ride of 2 years before I came out to my mother and then my father, and, you know, both were open and accepting. And so it's just been a fairly simple experience for me, luckily. And then, you know, one of the things that my mother did say to me, because I worked for a black gay organization in Rochester. And so one of the things that I found with my identity was that I had found this gay community. It was a gay community center, but there were very few people of color, particularly African Americans. And so while I had sort of found this sort of like a place to be gay, there wasn't a place for me. When we talk about the sort of validation of all of your identities, I didn't really have any black gay community. And so it was a few years before I found this organization that existed in Rochester.
Mm-hmm.
And that was a black gay organization. I'm like, oh my God, how could something exist in a city the size of Rochester, you know? And so then I began to volunteer for them. A job opened up and I ended up taking the job there. And in fact, for the first 4 years of my career post-college, I worked in recovery, in a recovery house. So I worked in a halfway house up there. That served the MICA population, mentally ill, chemically addicted population, which probably better terminology than that now. But so anyway, and so I left there and decided to work for this organization. And the first thing my mother said, are you sure that you want to put that on your resume? Like, this is your job. You're going to have to put this on your resume that you worked in this black gay organization. And I said, well, you know, thanks for the concern, Mom. But, you know, I think I'll be okay, you know, particularly because I worked in human services, and so I felt like this, you know, that this isn't going to be as stigmatized as, you know. And it's been, like, my career since then has, like, really taken off, and I've never had any issues.
That's great.
In fact, sit on the Mayor's Advisory Board for LGBT Affairs under Mayor Nutter, mm-hmm. under Gloria Casares as the Director of LGBT Affairs for the city, and have been involved in a number of other processes. But, you know, so I would never change any aspect of my life, quite honestly, and you know, it's just been a good ride.
That's great, man.
Well, that's a good way to maybe end this segment, because we kind of went very, very quickly, and I want to personally thank both of you for sharing your life with us, and it was very helpful and very, very informative.
Thanks for having us.
Yes, thanks for
That's it for this episode of Tapestry of Life. I'm Pascal Scoles. Contact us here at Community College of Philadelphia for more information about the behavioral health and human services. See you next time.